A West Virginia state legislator who recorded himself storming the Capitol this week has been arrested and faces criminal charges. Also arrested and charged, this man. This is the guy who broke into Speaker Pelosi's office, made himself comfortable, popped his feet up on the desk. These are just some of the charges that have been handed down in connection to the deadly siege that left multiple people dead, including a U.S. Capitol Police officer. CNN's Jessica Schneider is with me. And Jessica, I know investigators have said that they're looking for everyone that could be involved, but now they say they don't expect charges for a lot of the people who may have incited the crowd. Explain.
That's exactly right, Brooke. So they clarified a bit today, saying they do not expect to file charges against any of the speakers at that pre-riot rally. Of course, that rally and the speakers there included the president and Rudy Giuliani. Some have accused them both of inciting the crowd. But for now, investigators say the focus is squarely on those rioters who stormed the Capitol. And so far, prosecutors have filed charges against 15 people in federal court. They say there will be more, and they're revealing details about several of these charges. Of course, most notoriously, they've arrested and charged Richard Barnett. He is in custody in Arkansas, and he was the one, Brooke, you mentioned. He was photographed with his feet up on Nancy Pelosi's desk. You know, he bragged to a local TV station in Arkansas that he stole an envelope from her desk, but he is now under arrest, taken into custody in Little Rock, Arkansas, and he is facing federal charges. And that's in addition to Derek Evans, that delegate for the West Virginia legislature. He recorded himself storming the Capitol. He's now facing federal charges. And then prosecutors are also releasing more details, Brooke, about how this riot could have been much worse. They've arrested a man whose truck was found near the Capitol. And inside, they had previously told us they had found 11 Molotov cocktails that were ready to go. But now they're telling us they also found two handguns, an M4 assault rifle, gasoline, and also materials for homemade napalm that's used to make bombs and flamethrowers. So, Brooke, today we're getting the information about the people charged. We expect more people to be charged, both in federal court, and we're seeing people in the local D.C. courts as well, Brooke.
Listen, if you deny COVID, you don't believe in masks, you don't wear masks, you go mob, raid, incite violence on the Capitol, you're going to get your picture taken and they're going to come and find you. Jessica Schneider, thank you so much. With me now, CNN legal analyst and former federal prosecutor Elliot Williams, and CNN counterterrorism analyst and former CIA counterterrorism official Philip Mudd. Gentlemen, great to have you on. Elliot, just flat out, could the president of the United States actually face any charges here?
He could. At a minimum, you could have an investigation of the president for what would be inciting a riot. Literally, there's a federal riot act, for lack of a better term, that lays out, you know, when you have a group of individuals engaging in acts of violence. The problem is just going to be tricky to convict him of it. Like I said, you could investigate him for it, but you're going to have to prove that the specific acts of violence were at the behest of the person who'd urged them. Now, the president can certainly have the defense that, well, I was urging people to protest as is their right under the First Amendment, but those guys who were engaged in violence, that wasn't me. It's just going to be harder to prove, but you could certainly charge it and you could certainly investigate it.
And then, Phil, all these people, as I mentioned, you know, not wearing masks, so they're easily caught on video. They're being identified. You heard Jessica say the one guy is, like, bragging back home on his local news about how he stole whatever from Nancy Pelosi. I mean, not exactly a brilliant move, but great for law enforcement. You know, they're now going home, various corners of the country. They're trying to hide, some of them, scrubbing their social media. How does law enforcement track them all down?
Boy, there's a lot of work going into this. Look at what's available to law enforcement now. It's not only what they put up on social media and whether you can recover that later, you can. It's obviously what's on the video feeds going on in the Congress. Remember, just that day, when the day of the riot, there were FBI officials who went into that building. I presume that was for evidence collection, not only photographing the damage, but making sure that they recovered the video from that facility. And then the great revolution in the past few years, how many people took cell phone video, whether they were in the facility or not? So I think there's going to be not only a ton of evidence, but 50 people sounds like a few, a lot more prosecutions in the coming days. By the way, just one quick moment here on what the president-elect said, Biden. We just heard him on CNN a few minutes ago. I got to tell you, I was really surprised about what he said about the inauguration and encouraging Donald Trump, the president, not to attend for one simple reason. You realize the president has said that he wants to support a smooth transition. He has not said that he accepts the legitimacy of the election. I think that distinction is significant. If the president were to go to the inauguration, it makes it much harder for him to say, I do not accept Biden as the legitimate president of the United States. I think it's a mistake for a president-elect Biden not to encourage the president to attend.
I hear you. I appreciate you saying that. That's why we keep referring to that video from yesterday, is the non-concession. And, you know, Biden essentially saying he's thrilled he's not going to be coming, because that's the one thing, you know, that they can all agree upon, because this president, according to the president-elect, is just like this total embarrassment. Elliot, to the point, though, on that Phil was making about all these folks being prosecuted, all these rioters, how could they be charged, and how much jail time are we talking?
Oh, potentially a lot. And just to repeat the protest chant, lock them up, lock them all up. And, you know, they could potentially face a lot of charges. Now, look, there's no federal domestic terrorism statute that would allow for enhancements simply for the fact that there's terrorism. But there's all kinds of charges that these folks could be charged with: trespass, seditious conspiracy, damaging federal property, threatening federal officers, obstructing a proceeding of Congress, all kinds of things. Now, the far more important point, though, even more than the penalties they face, they really need to be tried in the District of Columbia. Now, many of them can and ultimately, sadly, will be tried in their jurisdictions back home, like this individual in Arkansas. The federal law probably will allow him to be tried in Arkansas. Look, if you're a prosecutor, you want the most friendly jury possible, and the jury you want is a jury pool of people who live in a place, work for the federal government, don't want to see their city terrorized, and are more likely to vote for a conviction. I think they're sort of playing with fire by letting all these guys go back home, get arrested back there, and be tried, frankly, in far more friendly jurisdictions. So bring them back here, or they should have arrested them when they were here and charged them. But it's potentially years of jail time, because a lot of these offenses could potentially be stacked on top of each other. And remember, there's, you know, there's acts of violence inside the Capitol building, and anyone who's present there can be charged and tried with some of the violent offenses and damaging property that other people engaged in. It's called accomplice liability. Everybody's these sort of thuggish accomplices working with each other. And yep, even if you're not the guy who broke the window, you could still be charged with it.
So given the violence that we've seen, right, the proven violence from this minority of Trump supporters this week on the Capitol, Phil, last question to you is just inauguration. You know, 12 days away, held out in the elements. How do we know that Biden and Harris will be safe?
I think there's a couple things. First, obviously, you'd expect to see a security presence that's unprecedented. But also, one of the questions from the past couple days is, why didn't federal authorities, including and Capitol Police authorities, see what was happening on social media and react more aggressively? I can guarantee you the feds, working with state and locals, are going to be looking not only at people who were involved a few days ago, but at anybody who's been in some of these circles like QAnon, to see if there's talk about the inauguration. A lot of preemptive work behind the scenes that's not physical, that's digital, Brooke.
Planned this whole thing, executed it, broad daylight. Broad daylight. Failure at so many levels. Phil Mudd, Elliot Williams. Guys, thank you so much.